The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. Welcome to worship on the second Sunday of Easter at West Raleigh Presbyterian Church. It is good and right that we are gathered and probably continuing to gather wherever you are in the houses and homes in the holy places of our Lord. As always, I would like to start with a special welcome. A welcome to anyone who is visiting with us, who is discerning your place in this family of faith, or perhaps even your place in the larger Church of Jesus Christ. We are glad that you're here, tuning in with us this morning. There are no strangers at West Raleigh, just friends that we have not yet met, and we hope that one day we will get to meet together and get to meet you in person. There are a couple of announcements for the life of our community that I do want to make. The first is a worship announcement about the bulletin. If you have not already done so, you should be able to pull up the bulletin either from the electronic newsletter that was sent this morning or in the same place under the same link as the YouTube channel through which you are viewing this broadcast. Welcome also to those who are coming from Sunday school. I just want to give a special shout out and thanks to those who are facilitating Sunday school for us on an ongoing basis through Zoom and teleconferencing. It is a gift and a privilege to be able to continue our study of scripture and fellowship together. So thank you to those coming from Sunday school virtually and to those who are guiding our classes through it right now. I do want to announce that a new class starts next week, led by Reverend Dr. Rob Evans, on the resurrection stories of our Lord. There are not many of them, but they each tell us something about the risen Christ and who we are called to be as the body of Christ. If you're interested in joining this class virtually, you can contact the church office through email or through phone this week, and we will make sure that you are connected to that Sunday school class next week. Many of you will know and remember that we were supposed to be at Montreat right now. We were supposed to be worshiping in just two places, here in the sanctuary and at Montreat. Obviously, that is not going to happen this spring. However, we have rebooked Montreat for next September 17th and 18th. We are hoping to rally in the mountains next fall. So if you have already signed up for that retreat and would like to just move your deposit for next fall's retreat, you may do that. If you need to cancel, we totally understand. Just let us know through the church office again. And if you'd like to sign up to be a part of that retreat, there is plenty of time left to do that. Clap for Caregivers is happening again at 6 o'clock tonight. We invite everyone all of Raleigh to go to your front doors and make noise with hands or pots and pans or instruments to clap and give thanks for those caregivers, doctors, nurses, first responders, and essential workers who are continuing to care for our community as we weather this pandemic. I think that is all of the announcements for the life of our community at this moment. Friends, come, let us worship Almighty God.
Thank you.
Friends, as you pull up your call to worship, I do want to circle back to one announcement that I apologize for not speaking out loud, and that is next Sunday at 12:15 following worship, we will have a virtual congregational meeting for the purpose of electing officers and of reviewing the pastor's terms of call. The session has made accommodations to do this virtually. We will ratify the virtual meeting with an in-person meeting later this year. And there will be directions to tune in to that meeting coming in this week's e-news. They've already gone out by hard copy to those who receive the electronic newsletter through the mail. And if you want to test your technology ahead of time, please just be in touch with Anna Richardson Robb in the church office or myself, and we'll make sure that you've got what you need to join us for that meeting next Sunday. I invite you to join together for the call to worship. With Mary, whose glad tidings signaled hope and summoned joy, we proclaim, we have seen the Lord. With the disciples whom Jesus greeted with peace and freed from fear, we declare, we have seen the Lord. Behold, even though this Easter has not been like those that we've known before, the risen Lord is in our midst. As we gather in homes and holy places, the first thing that we do as Easter people is get honest about who we are. Proclaim that we are broken people living in a broken world, but yet that brokenness does not have the last word. So as we say our prayer of confession together, lean in, receiving and opening our hearts to God's grace, knowing that Christ appears among us to bring a word of peace and forgiveness before these words of confession ever leave our lips. So friends, come, let us confess who we are together. Risen Lord, you have breathed the Spirit upon us. Yours is a spirit that does not know boundaries, boundaries created by nation and tribe, boundaries kept by social distancing, or boundaries made necessary by infection for protection. It is your spirit that holds us together when we feel like falling apart. It is your spirit that opens our eyes to your presence when fear clouds our vision. It is your spirit that opens our hearts to those who love you as deeply as you love us. Yet, when we are isolated and protected, even when it is for the greater good, we risk those barriers becoming a barrier between you and us, between us and them. In your great mercy, forgive us. Breathe on us, Spirit of God. When we yearn for more proof, open our eyes. When we yearn for more courage, strengthen us. When we yearn for guidance, reassure us of your way. When we yearn for more faith, give us hope. Easter in us, so that we may proclaim, we have seen the Lord. Friends, the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Hear and see and remember these waters of grace. For God's grace is poured out for you, for your children, and for your children's children. Indeed, God's grace is poured out for the life of the whole world. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old is gone, and it makes way for new creation, for new grace, for honest forgiveness, for a hopeful Easter future. Friends, hear and believe in the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Know this and be at peace. This Sunday, we are moving back for our children's lesson to our Lord's Prayer Board. So I invite everyone, especially our young Christians, but certainly not just our young Christians, to join me over here next to the prayer board, the Lord's Prayer Board that Marty Lemming made in honor and in memory of her mother. I want to remember back for just a few minutes as to how this all got started, so that we can also remember how we are called to pray and to be together in the future. So many of you will remember, if you were here on the first Sunday of Lent when we started this Lord's Prayer Board, this idea came to Marty Lemming when she found a litany that her mother led with a German counterpart in Germany in 1965. She was living in Germany with her family. Her father was in military service, and they were living on or near base. And there was a women's group of American military women and of their German counterparts. And they would meet for Bible study and for prayer. And at some point during those years, sometime in 1965, the women got together and they did this service, honoring and celebrating the Lord's Prayer and the unity that they have in that prayer. So I want you to hold your hands out with palms up for a few minutes, hands out and palms up, and then put your fingers together, creating a web. Get them really close so you can't see any air between your fingers. Put them together like a great web. Now look at your hands for a few minutes and imagine this web is the church. It's the body of Christ, and it stretches backwards through your parents to your grandparents and your great-grandparents and your great-great-grandparents, those whose names you don't know, uncles and aunts, friends and neighbors, all have been saying this prayer for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. It's one of the first prayers that we teach our children. They hear us say it when we gather here in the sanctuary. You heard your parents saying it before you even knew the words yourself. And now you are part of that web of people. And one day it is our hope and our prayer that you will teach it. Maybe to your children or your children's children, maybe as a Sunday school teacher to the children of the church. maybe to someone who comes in need and asking you to pray with them, and you will know the words of these prayers when you don't know anything else to say. Now, if you look at our web, at this prayer that binds us together, you'll notice that it also creates a cradle. It holds us. There are times in life when we don't have words to pray. They can be joyful times when we are super excited and grateful, and they can also be really hard and sad times when we don't have the words. But that's why we learn this prayer, because these words and this prayer, they cradle us and they hold us and they remind us that we are always held by God. So friends, whenever you are needing to feel connected to God, connected to people who love you, to your parents, grandparents, caretakers, put your hands together. Remember all of those people who have gone before you, all of those people who love you and take care of you, all those people that form your church and your school community, and remember that you are held and loved in their care and in God's care. And then try saying this Lord's Prayer to remember that that connection is real and it's strong and it will give you strength. So in going back through our prayer, one final time for this use of the prayer board, I invite you to turn to your litany. And we are going to say and to remember each phrase of this prayer that binds us together and that binds us to God. Our Father, not my Father, but our Father, who art in heaven. God is beyond the blue, but the Spirit of God and the love of God and the light of God surround you and us always. Hallowed be thy name. You are always an everlasting God, and we will praise and protect your holy name. Thy kingdom come. May God hasten the royal purple day when Jesus will reign. Thy will be done. As God's will is done in our hearts, we truly pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Get a little bit more light here. Let us rest in the promise that there will be enough. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. God's forgiveness is steadfast, and we draw from God's own love and strength to help us forgive. Lead us not into temptation. If God is leading, then wherever we go, whatever our surroundings and temptations, we will be led to life, to what is good, holy, and just, to a life that stands forever. But deliver us from evil. We pray for God to deliver us from the darkness of evil and into the way of love. The white candle, and I'm going to go ahead and light this last orange candle as well. The white candle represents the great throne, the seat of God's power. When all other kingdoms and powers have failed, God's kingdom remains steadfast and holy, merciful and mighty. The last candle that I lit, the orange candle, reminds us of the dominant color of a sunset. And yet, the most glorious of all sunsets are but a faint reflection of the glory of God. They are God's handiwork. No prayer is so full of divine radiance as the Lord's Prayer. It calls the world to prayer. It can be said in less than 1 minute, and yet it contains within itself every petition that we can ask of God. We could spend hours on this prayer without ever finishing it. It's like the chimes of a great cathedral, calling the world to prayer, So let us heed God's call as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. May we let the light of the Lord's Prayer shine in our hearts today, so that we may learn to truly pray. I invite you to join with me in the reading and praying of Psalm 16. You can also find it printed in your bulletin. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the holy ones in the land, they are the noble, in whom is all my delight. Those who choose another God multiply their sorrows. Their libations I will not pour out or take their names upon my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me. Because God is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore my heart is glad. And my soul rejoices, my body also rests secure. For you do not give me up to Sheol, or let your faithful one see the pit. You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. This reading from John's Gospel, chapter 20, beginning with verse 19. Again, hear what the Spirit has to say to the church. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and then the disciples rejoiced, for they had seen the Lord. Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12 who was not with them when Jesus came, so the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger on the mark, in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." So a week later, when the disciples were again in the house, and Thomas this time was with them, although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them. "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." This is the word of our Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God. For 1 year in high school, I participated in an interdisciplinary American Studies program. We did all kinds of project-based learning that integrated history and literature, culture and politics. And there are a couple of projects that I did during that year that have stuck with me, but one in particular came back to me this week. I don't remember the specific assignment, but I do remember driving all over town photographing doors. The front doors of homes, big doors like the one into the President's Mansion at the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa where I grew up, medium and smaller homes and doors in neighborhoods around town, mobile home doors, doors into the rural farmhouses of those out in the country. I found unique doors, carved and painted doors, but the one that stands out in my memory is an elevated side door that went into a condominium-style twin home. At some point, there must have been stairs leading up that side yard into those doors, but that must have been years before, because when I took the picture, the door seemed to float about 4 feet above the lawn. What I realized this week as I thought about all of those doors was that all of them, every single one of them, had been closed, shut tightly, leading to people and lives and decisions, joys and struggle, generations of people and families and stories living behind those shut doors. And then I thought about all of us right now, during the pandemic, living behind our own closed doors, staying connected through worship and phone calls and Zoom calls and texts and emails and FaceTime, but all, or at least mostly all, behind shut doors. Some people working, others not. Some parents homeschooling, others having neither the temperament nor the bandwidth to homeschool. Others grateful for online school, for districts reaching out to feed and teachers teaching and connecting with our kids. Some families feeling cramped and confined in their homes, other single people living alone and feeling more isolated than ever. As I look through the camera and see us gathered, huddled behind closed doors, celebrating birthdays and anniversaries, caring for aging parents and partners, grieving all sorts of loss. And I know that the problems that were there before the pandemic have sometimes been made worse by the pandemic. And our doors are shut, and we are trying desperately not to let our hearts close. And it's hard, and it's tiring, and it's disorienting because it's Easter, and it is spring, and we are supposed to be at Montreat on a retreat, and yet it is still pandemic time. So somehow this year, this story resonates with our story as loudly and as clearly as ever. Mary Magdalene announced, "I have seen the Lord," but no one else had yet had this glorious moment of recognition. Instead, they are huddled behind doors that have been shut and locked out of fear. Everyone was affected by the crucifixion. It was a horrible event to witness. Jesus was their friend. And if they had been struck in some sort of fear and shock and trauma-induced malaise 3 days earlier, the finality of Jesus' death was beginning to sink in, even as hope began to slip away from them. The world was gray, sleep was restless, food did not taste as good, they were anxious and tired. They were tired even though they realized all they had done for the last 3 days was stay in that room together. They weren't sure what was to come next. They were not sure what to do next. Doesn't that sound eerily familiar? That room, that moment, that feeling. It was into that time of waiting, of pause, of fear, of grief, of tired, of disorientation that Jesus returned again. It was through those shut doors, through those closed hearts, that he came and he stood among them. "Peace be with you," he said. And in hearing his voice, they began to remember what he taught them before his death, to remember the overwhelming love with which he had lived his life, to remember how he had saved people, liberating them from their own internal demons, turning water into wine, feeding thousands of people with just a few fish and a few loaves of bread. They remember how he held church and culture and politicians accountable to what they knew was right, especially when it came to showing mercy and dignity and humanity to the least and the last and the lost. Their eyes were open. They recognized Jesus. He had returned. Mary Magdalene had told them as much earlier in that day, but let's face it, resurrection is something that we all want to see and to feel and to know for ourselves before we believe. But it was him. And their hearts were lifted as this glimmer of hope slipped behind and into those closed rooms and shut up hearts. Then John says, "The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord." And Jesus continued, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And then John says, he breathed on him and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And then they finally remembered to breathe. Something inside of them that had been emptied out began to refill. Life started to look a little bit more like it was worth living. They could feel that energy returning to their gut, kindling the fire that had been within them. If he was not dead, then maybe there would be more to this story. In the presence of the risen Lord, they began to remember, to put back together who Jesus was in life, who he said they could be, who he said they should be. And then he reminded them that they must forgive, that their life together depended on their ability to forgive. "If you forgive the sins of any," he said to them, "they are forgiven." And having just been through a crucifixion, an unjust murder, they began to fully understand the complexity of what this would mean for their future. Their minds began to spin again with possibility and with hope. This is not the first time that the people of God have huddled behind closed doors waiting for Easter to happen, wondering if Easter would happen, wondering if Easter did happen, if it would matter much anyway in this world. This is not even the first time that the church has struggled with this question during a pandemic. In fact, in 1527, just 10 years into the Reformation, the bubonic plague came to Wittenberg, Germany. Some people asked Martin Luther to flee the city to protect himself, while others looked to him to know if it would be faithful for them to flee. One pastor wrote to Martin Luther repeatedly, asking Luther if he could flee. Finally, Luther was compelled to write him back, and you can read the entire letter in what is now called Whether One May Flee from a Deadly Plague. And there are a couple of parts of Luther's letter that I found interesting as I read it earlier this week that resonate with our current epidemic. First, he said, the preacher cannot flee. We are called, he says, to stay and to minister to God's people and to have faith. He writes, those who are engaged in a spiritual ministry such as preachers and pastors must likewise remain steadfast before the peril of death. For when people are dying, they most need a spiritual ministry which strengthens and comforts. But he doesn't stop with pastors and with preachers. Luther goes on to say that public officials and those who are nursing the sick are also called to stay in order to take care of one another. And then Luther goes on to say that that choice extends to all Christians. Now he does say that we are not to put our bodies at an unnecessary risk, and each person must discern how they are called to respond in each moment of crisis based on their own unique set of circumstances. But the bottom line is this, he says, preserving our own life can never come at the expense of someone else. Now, if a deadly epidemic strikes, Luther writes, we should stay where we are, make our preparations, and take courage in the fact that we are mutually bound together so that we cannot desert one another or flee from one another. For this is who we are, bound together with past and future in the present as the people of God. This is what is in our DNA. It might even be, friends, what we were made for, why we were bound together as the body of Christ, in order to bear witness to the living Lord who appears behind tightly shut doors, breathing on us the breath of the Spirit, saying to us, peace be with you. So imagine with me for a minute. Imagine what happens if we retrace the steps of Jesus through Holy Week, knowing what we know now as Easter people. Would we have the courage to enter Jerusalem with its halls of power and challenge the very institutions that we have built to organize and order our life together? Would we be able to challenge them to care for everyone equally and fully? Would we be able to sit at the Lord's table on the night of his arrest and confess our own propensity for betrayal and for denial and for indifference? And would we be able to look at one another sitting around the table, having confessed our own brokenness, and receive and offer mercy and forgiveness and grace? Would we be able to stay awake in the garden with Jesus while he grew more and more agitated, and it became clear that there are parts of our life that are outside of our control and beyond our understanding? And then standing at the foot of the cross, would we have heard the voices and the words of the two incarcerated men who hung next to Jesus? Would we have heard them say to him, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom? And would we have been able to hear and understand Jesus' response, today you will be with me in paradise? as Easter people, would we have been able to see our salvation, our liberation, as inextricably bound to theirs? Church of Jesus Christ, this is not an exercise of imagination. This is who we are, and this is who we are called to be. We are Easter people living in this Good Friday world, called, as Luther said, to make our preparations and to take courage in the fact that we are mutually bound together, so that we cannot desert or leave or flee from one another. Because the living God appears behind closed doors and works in shut hearts, and this is where we must be echoing the words of the resurrected Lord, "Peace be with you," until the doors open and the light shines and hearts begin to warm again with hope. So it sounds like a lot, especially in a crisis, and it is. Living as Easter people in a Good Friday world involves risk and vulnerability. It involves failure and honesty. It requires hope even when we are huddled behind tightly closed doors, risking our hearts shuddering. We will need to see for ourselves just like Thomas did. Thomas, who among us wants to be remembered as the one who doubted? Especially when I don't think that it was doubt exactly that Thomas expressed. Thomas, remember, had not been with the other disciples a week earlier when Jesus came and first stood among them. Just like they had not been with Mary when Jesus appeared in the garden next to her. So when the disciples told Jesus that they had seen him, Thomas wanted to see for himself. Thomas did not doubt. He just wanted what they had had. He wanted to have his spirits lifted by the presence of the living Lord. He wanted to bear witness to the God who kept appearing behind closed doors. He wanted to rise up like Mary and the disciples before him and to be able to say for himself, "I have seen the Lord." And isn't that what each and every one of us want to do? And church, the wonder of this story is that when Thomas asked, Jesus met Thomas right where he was, behind yet another shut door. It was a week later. The disciples, this time with Thomas, are again in the house. And John says, although the doors were shut, Jesus came among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he invited Thomas to touch his hands and his side, to retrace the marks of Good Friday on Jesus' own body. They were still there. They had not been erased. They were scars and memories that also bore with them possibility, potential, and hope. And Thomas, like Mary and the disciples before him, proclaimed for himself, "My God and my Lord." Friends, Church of Jesus Christ, Easter people, living in a frightening and changing and disorienting Good Friday world, hear the good news of the gospel. Jesus appears among us, breathing life into the church gathered and into the church scattered, and says, "Peace be with you. As I have sent the Son, now I am sending you. Go with that peace to live and to love and to serve the Lord." Alleluia and amen.
They saw.
We gather around the table, remembering that we do not gather alone. I invite you to look at page 7 of your bulletin. There are some new joys and concerns there. For a full prayer list, just contact the church office and we can send that to you by email. But it is with gratitude and thanksgiving that I let the church gather know that Sarita Eisenbees returned home from the hospital earlier this week after being hospitalized due to COVID-19. We continue to pray for the healthcare workers locally and nationally and globally, for those who are overstretched due to the pandemic and those also whom are understretched and waiting to be able to serve people who are not receiving healthcare right now as we turn our attention to COVID-19. We pray with and for Dylan Ward, Susan and Joe Ward's son, who had a cochlear implant on Wednesday. He is resting and recuperating and waiting to see how that will open his ears more fully. And we pray with and for Elizabeth and Dan Turk, who are now out of quarantine in Florida with family, but also who are deeply in prayer for their friends and chosen family in Madagascar who over the last week is experiencing a rapid increase in COVID-19 cases. And finally, we pray for Barry Marks, who remains in Florida with his family, but who is sick and especially disoriented during this time. We pray for his comfort and his peace and for his feeling of connection. Friends, let us pray. Gracious and loving, almighty and breath-giving God, as we imagine ourselves, as we are behind our own locked and closed doors, we give you thanks for the Spirit of God that continues to come and to tabernacle among us, saying to us, "Peace, I am with you," reminding us that we are a sent people, that we are not scattered without purpose, but that we are spread over the whole wide world to be the body of Christ on earth as it is in heaven. As we gather as this body today, as West Raleigh Presbyterian Church, yet gathered with the Church of Jesus Christ around the world, we remember that we are Easter people. We trace the scars and the wounds of Holy Week, giving thanks that in your humanity, you are bound to us, and that in your divinity, we are bound to you, and that we are called and claimed to be Easter people, even and especially in the midst of a Good Friday world. We pray for the church. We pray that this Easter may be a time of renewal and rebirth, that we may learn more deeply and fully that which we did not before understand, that we may be connected more tightly to those with whom over time we have become disconnected and unknown. We pray that you will give the church clarity of purpose and of call, clarity of ministry and of mission, that you will open our hearts and breathe into us so that we too may proclaim with hopefulness that we have seen and we believe. And Lord, hear our prayers for the world, for a world that at times seems like a global village, small and interconnected, and for a world at times that seems at odds with itself, turning on one another, pushing each other away. Lord, help us to feel and to know and to be your connection, to see our brothers and sisters, our siblings in Christ, not just as those whose names we know, who we sit next to, who we worship with, who call themselves Presbyterians or Christians, but with those who are scattered around the whole world, also behind doors and hearts sometimes tightly shut. May we hear those words of the necessity of forgiveness, and may we live into what it means to mirror and be that forgiveness, so this web of your body may not be broken. And Lord, we ask for courage and strength to be poured out in special measure to those who are on the front lines, whether it's in hospitals or through ambulances, through being a public servant, elected office, working in our countries, our world's grocery stores and pharmacies. Lord, pour out the power of your Spirit in special measure. May they feel the peace of your presence and a sense of purpose in your calling. May they know the gratitude. May we feel and be and express the gratitude that is in equal measure to their service. Hear the prayers of your people, those ones that are on our hearts as individuals, for our own grief and joy, for our own families and fears, for our own life and livelihoods. Hear the prayers of all of your people. And may we continue to hear your voice, to feel your breath, to experience your peace, and to be and become Easter people. For it is in the name and at the call of Jesus Christ that we have gathered, that we will scatter, but that we will never lose our connection. It is in the name of the one to whom we belong always that all God's people say together, Alleluia and Amen. Friends, it is the time of our weekly offering. And on behalf of West Raleigh Presbyterian Church and the session, I want to say thank you. Thank you for your weekly faithfulness in the giving of your time, your tithes, and your offerings. For it is through those offerings of time and of financial support that we are able to continue to gather and to be supported in the work of ministry. I want to say a special thanks to everyone who has continued to support the feeding ministry, especially through the offering for sandwiches. We have received over $2,000 in abundance of support for that ministry. Not only is that ministry supporting those who come to our doors every Monday and Wednesday and Friday with a fresh sandwich, as well as some other non-perishable foods for the rest of their day, but it's also supporting a local business for which they have expressed special gratitude as well. I also want to bring our attention back to the brown bag offering. Way back in the beginning of Lent, many or most of you received a brown bag to drop in your offerings throughout the season of Lent. This is the Sunday that we traditionally collect these brown bags with a wagon that comes up and down the aisle of the sanctuary. I invite you to continue to give to this offering, to send it in by whatever means is useful to you, whether that is through a check in the mail or through electronic giving. You can mark it for use for the sandwiches for the feeding ministry, or you can mark it for the general feeding ministry. Either way, it will go in support of our brown bag lunch every Monday and Wednesday and Friday. And for that, your abundant giving is reflected in our abundant gratitude. Thank you. Freely, church, we can continue to receive abundant grace. Freely, let us also give of our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious God, we do give you thanks, for you remind us always that there is enough, that we have enough. And with that promise, you enable us to release part of which you have given us to steward, to share so that all may have enough. Thank you for your generosity made known through the Church of Jesus Christ. May that generosity continue to grow and live and abide among us. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
There's a dawn in every darkness. our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity, in our death a resurrection, at the last a victory, unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Friends, go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak and help the suffering. Honor and serve all people, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessings of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be, rest, and abide with you, with everyone who is known and dear to you, and with those who are only known and dear to God. Friends, go in peace to love and to serve the Lord, knowing that you are God's beloved child forever. And all God's people say, Alleluia and Amen.